Let me introduce the fourth speaker, Dr. Dharmendra Sheth. Dr. Sheth is an engineer turned teacher, teacher trainer, and corporate trainer with more than two decades of experience. Apart from an engineering qualification, he has an MA, a PhD, a TESOL certificate from Wisconsin University, US. He has prepared thousands of learners for tests such as IELTS, IELTS, TOEFL, and PTE. During his tenure as a National Vice President, LTI, he was instrumental in strengthening networks of ELT professionals in India. May I now request Dr. Sheth to take over?
Yes. Thank you, Kiran, for the introduction. Thank you, LTI Pune chapter, my dear friend, Dr. Zaidan Patil, Atul, Rahul, Kiran, everyone. Why am I the last speaker? In fact, I have always faced this situation ever since my childhood. Even at school, I was the last person to do any good, whenever there was anything good. And in fact, many teachers were happy when I was absent. Anyway, this is the best of times, this is the worst of times. Pre-lunch session, and that too after three speakers, and that too after a topic which is very dear to my heart, critical thinking. So my critical thinking ability tells me that participants, either in the Zoom meeting or those who are watching on Facebook, can postpone the lunch for about half an hour because we had some technical problems. And I would like Rahul or Atul to let me know when I have last 2 minutes. In fact, vocabulary is the last topic for the day today, and that is probably the case even in research, if not the last, but then not the prominent item as well. So let me start with my presentation. After this presentation, after our discussion for say 15 minutes, if I say you are going to be a totally different teacher from tomorrow, your way of looking at language will drastically change. Your way of teaching vocabulary will change significantly. If I said that, I'd be telling a lie. Right? So keeping that in mind, let's begin. And I would like Atul or Rahul to just let me know if there is any technical problem, if you're not able to see or if I'm not audible. Let me begin by seeking blessings of my gurus, Dr. Sudhakar Marathe and Mrs. Marathe. Many of you have attended probably his sessions, even in our LTI Pune chapter. So if I had just 1 minute for this presentation, then what would I say? Keeping that in mind, I have prepared this particular slide. Here I'm going to tell you the resources that I have used for this presentation plus my normal classroom teaching. The first is here. Before the actual use of computers and technology in vocabulary research, whatever research was done before 1980, that is very nicely summarized in Paul Meara's book, Vocabulary Acquisition. And even at that time, if you see the title, it was a neglected aspect of language learning and language teaching. So this book has heavily influenced me. After that, if you want to know whatever research has happened in the recent past, in the last, say, 20, 25 years, then probably one of the eminent scholars is Paul Nation. And one of the books that I have used for my presentation is mentioned here, but I also used many of his articles, and they're extremely useful. And the latest one, 2019, the handbook, which is one of the masterpieces for today's researchers, those who are interested in vocabulary research, or those who want to know various shades of vocabulary learning and teaching, then probably this will be one of the best resources. And one old book which I want to mention now, because these days we have a lot of online teaching, and most people, most teachers are comfortable making presentations. So what I saw during, say, 80s, using paper and pen kind of material, the method was programmed vocabulary, where everything was available in the book itself, and it was a kind of self-study material. And I was fascinated by that material. And there are many books available on the market, old books, and one of them is this one. So probably now, when we want to make our learners independent learners of English, at that time we can use such material for our online teaching. Okay, so with this background, let me begin. First of all, as teachers of English, we should know why we create any vocabulary activity, because different activities have different purposes. For example, we want to introduce new words with this activity. We want to generate interest in word study. We want to solidify whatever words students already know. Or do you want to enrich previously met words? Enrich in the sense, suppose a word has 10 shades of meaning and the students may be familiar with one shade or one aspect of vocabulary. Then by this activity, you want to teach more shades of meaning, maybe pronunciation, collocation, all kinds of things. Then some of the activities are to teach vocabulary learning strategies, because how to learn vocabulary, how to increase one's word power, that's also an important area. And many students, they may not be familiar with how to learn vocabulary. So certain activities can be to teach how to learn vocabulary. Another aspect which I am very fond of is developing automaticity. What we can say fluency in terms of reading as well as in speaking. So certain activities where we have previously met vocabulary, students already know that vocabulary, there are some formulaic expressions also, and we create some material. And when students read quickly or when they listen to very quickly, they develop automaticity. And certain vocabulary activities can be to assess vocabulary knowledge of our students. And sometimes we use a vocabulary activity to teach some other aspect of language. For example, in many course books, you might have seen that in the beginning, there is some vocabulary activity, then discussion topic or dialogues are given, so speaking activity, and then at the end, they may listen to something. So vocabulary activities can be used to teach some other aspect of language. Now, some of my premises and some scattered ideas about vocabulary teaching. One of the fundamental principles that we as teachers need to know, and as learners we have to tell our learners, that words in isolation have no fixed meaning at all. It is impossible. If somebody asks you the meaning of XYZ, then your answer should always be where. That's what my teacher, Dr. Sudhakar Marathe, says. Words, they don't have meaning. For example, if I ask you what is the meaning of, say, I, you can't say, because I may be referring to a grammatical item. I may be referring to the part of my body. I may be referring to the eye of a needle. I may be referring to eye of a storm, right? I may be referring to that eye, sir, in sailor terminology. I may be referring to that animal which makes a dii sound. So words acquire meaning only because of the context and the co-text. Context is the situation in which that word occurs, and co-text means all the words before and after that particular word. I cannot see the participants. So Rahul and Atul, can you just say whether everything is okay?
Yes, sir. Absolutely fine.
Yeah, fine. Now, another aspect, when we design any vocabulary activity, then we need to keep in mind the learning burden. That means the amount of effort that is required on learner's part to carry out that activity. For example, if you add words like very highfalutin words in an activity of, say, 1 minute, say, words like serendipitous, then gargantuan, so that will increase the learning burden, and that might put off some learners. That is the case with many good, actually, course books also for vocabulary development. So keep in mind the learning burden. Now, if you see modern, or not just modern, but whatever vocabulary research, that can be classified into three categories, according to Paul Nation again. So one is description about how vocabulary is learned, how are words stored, right? What factors affect. So all these kinds of description, that is one area of research. Second is pedagogy. What kind of activities are created? What material is used? How it is used? And the final is assessment. So one of these three areas you can take up if you are interested in research. Then if you see before 80s, most research was based on, and even classroom teaching for vocabulary, was based on single word items. And then gradually we realized that it is important to study multi-word items like phrasal verbs and formulaic expressions, right? Then one particular, distinction you will often come across in vocabulary study and research is intentional teaching of vocabulary and incidental learning of vocabulary. For example, both have their pros and cons, no doubt. I would go for both. So in intentional, you create activities, you have a set of words in mind, you want to teach those words, you want to teach certain aspects of that particular set of words. So that is intentional. And at the end, you can also, assess whatever you have taught, whether the learners have acquired that set of words. And incidental is more about providing a lot of input to students in terms of reading and listening, and it is like carefully created material, definitely. And they acquire words and expressions as a byproduct. They may be carrying out an activity, they may be reading a story, and they acquire vocabulary. These are some scattered ideas, but very important because each will require half an hour. So I'm just throwing ideas. Another important area to keep in mind while teaching vocabulary is the breadth of a word. The breadth of a word, that means if you take any word, then the word has its spelling, its pronunciation, its friends, what we say collocation in modern terminology, right? Word partnership, is it used in some idiom? What are the associations of that word, right? In what context is it used? Is it a formal word, informal word? Does it have any gender aspect, right? Politeness aspect. So all these things about a word, that is called the breadth of a word. And the depth means to what extent any learner has mastered a particular aspect, right? For example, some students, they might be able to recognize a word, they might be able to use that word in their writing, but when it comes to speaking, they find it very difficult. So their depth is limited, right? Certain areas of certain aspects are not very strong. They may be good writers, but they may not be good speakers. And the final is fluency. As I mentioned, automaticity, that is our final goal. Students, when they listen to or read some particular words, their brain should not spend any time on thinking. It should become automatic, right? In fact, in modern research, when we have MRIs and all technical gadgets with which we can even check the eye movements. So these things are used to learn or to understand the automaticity, where students falter, where do they need to read it again. So these things are also very important in vocabulary study. And my premise is we can never do enough to improve our vocabulary. Now, another question which people keep asking me, and many readers, oh sorry, many scholars have answered this question in their own ways. Now, there is a consensus on the words, on the figures that I've given. How many words does one need? So to understand most forms of speech, you have about 3,000 most frequently used word families. Now, when I say word families, it is not just one word. So if you know compete, if you know the word compete, right? And if you don't know competition or competitive, right? Then you don't know the word family, right? So compete, competition, competitive, competitively. When you know all these words, then you know that particular word family, right? And some word families are too big. By adding prefixes and suffixes, you can have a huge family, like nation, national, nationalized, international, internationalized, pro-internationalizationism. You can create long words like that, families. So 3,000 word families. In fact, you have seen most dictionaries, they give their defining vocabulary. And normally in their defining vocabulary, they use most frequently used word families. If you're not seeing, you can refer to any online dictionary and you can click the defining vocabulary section. In fact, the first very interesting set that I came across after Michael West's list was Macmillan Dictionary. When they introduced their first dictionary on CD, they gave very nice explanation of defining vocabulary and explanation. Then we have, suppose you want to understand most forms of written text, then according to Paul Nation again, or maybe, I don't know whether it was Paul or Stuart, I don't know. But 8,000 most frequently used word families. And to have the vocabulary similar to that of an educated L1 user, then it required 15,000 word families. Now to become a good teacher of English, how many word families are required? You decide. Now, what do you know actually when you say you know a word? Now this is probably one of the best parts of Paul Nation's work that I've come across. He says that when your learners are able to recognize the spoken form of the word, right, then you can say you partially know a word because there are many other things coming. Then being able to pronounce the word, because if you're not able to pronounce, then it may be an awkward situation sometimes. I remember one of the students, when I gave him a story to read, he came back and he said, "What is Champagni?" Now I had no idea, and I used all my knowledge of 20 years of teaching and learning, and I couldn't find out the meaning of that word. He said, "What is that? Let me see." And he showed me the word, and it was champagne. So being able to pronounce the word is also a part of the knowledge of vocabulary. Then being able to spell the word. Yeah, sometimes it is required for everyone, for students basically. Being able to write the word, right? In primary schools, for example, they teach you writing words, then letters. That's an important skill. Knowing the underlying meaning of the word. Now, this is very important. For example, in this monsoon season, you see different clouds in the sky, different types of clouds, right? In almost every season, you see clouds. We call them clouds because the common meaning, the concept that we have is cloud. But if you see, all clouds are different. And because they are different, they will have different words, right? But there is a possibility that they will have different words. So if your clouds very near the earth, almost heavy, full of water, then we call it nimbus. If it is very far, feathery, very soft, then we say cirrus. And in children's literature, if you have seen, there is a cloud, on that another cloud, on that another cloud. So that is cumulus. So underlying meaning is one thing. And plus there are many other you know, associations in a way. Yeah, it was published in 1994. Now, knowing the range of meanings of the word, one word multiple meanings, obviously. In fact, you take any common word. You know, sometimes people ask me, what should we do for to improve the breadth of vocabulary? You know, it is not always necessary to learn new words. In fact, whatever words you know, if you learn more shades of meaning of that word, that also you can increase your vocabulary. And let me go back to my first slide, just mentally, and tell you that the book that I recommended, Programmed Vocabulary. In that book, you'll be surprised to find that they have taken only 14 words, 14 words to teach 14,000 words. If you don't believe me, you can send me a WhatsApp message. I'll respond to that with a picture of that particular book and the passage in which it is written. So just 14 words, but if you study them in totality, then you can learn 14,000 words in English. Imagine. So range of meanings. You take any word, point, for example, right? Point. That's a good point. Point of the pointed part of something, that's also a point, right? Bullet points. So many points. Any random word you take, and then it will have multiple meanings. Then knowing the grammatical patterns of the word fits into. Because I'm sure you know that every word has its own grammar. Words don't behave in a random way. For example, I like playing cricket possible. I love playing cricket possible. I enjoy playing cricket possible. I like to play cricket possible. I love to play cricket possible. I enjoy to play cricket not possible. Why? Because enjoy word itself tells you that use the ing form after me, if that's a verb. So knowing the grammatical patterns of the word fits into, that's an important area of knowing a word. Then knowing the affixes the word stem can take, obviously. In fact, many teachers love that topic, but there we have to be careful because some of the prefixes, they behave in a slightly strange way. For example, in does not always make a word opposite. Appropriate, inappropriate, fine. Accessible, inaccessible, fine, right? But flammable and inflammable, they are the same. Valuable and invaluable are the same, right? Then knowing the words that fit into the same lexical sets. For example, this is a very important area, in fact. When I was a student, it was given a lot of importance, lexical sets. I don't know, today it has taken a back seat. For example, if I want to describe a person, I can say he is very rigid. Now, in place of rigid, what are the other words that I can take that forms a lexical set? And it is an important feature of vocabulary study. Mm-hmm. Because when you are speaking, you don't have luxury to wait. You cannot tell people, okay, wait, let me think about the right word, and then I'll tell you. You will have to make do with the most, you know, the nearest word that comes to your mind. And that is possible only if you have a range of words for that. You can say rigid, inflexible, uncompromising, unyielding, adamant, stubborn, right? And Dr. Zen Patel can give you 20 more words. Then knowing the typical associations of the word. Every word has some associations, right? In fact, if you take any random word, say a lock, the moment I say the word a lock, you'll think about the key, you'll think about security and 1,000 other associations. So that knowing more associations of the words can help you improve your fluency in reading, writing, speaking in every way. Then knowing the range of collocations of the word. I'm sure this is a very important area today. Many people in India are also working on these collocations. So basically it is word partnership. Every word will go with some fixed words. Some are very strong collocations. For example, if you take the word inclement. Now inclement word you will always find with weather, bad weather. So inclement weather. Inclement, you will not use it for a person or for a food item, no. Inclement weather, so that's a very strong collocation. Some are average. For example, if you take a word like abject. So the word abject, which conveys a very negative meaning, like some people live in abject poverty. So poverty is a negative connotation. With that, we use abject. Abject failure is possible, right? So abject has slightly more friends than inclement. And some words like good, they have hundreds of friends. Many things can be good. Then knowing whether the word, the use of the word is limited by considerations of politeness, gender, age, all these things are important. For example, if I enter Dr. Zarin Patil's office, I will not say, can I come in? I'll say, may I come in, sir? So may indicates politeness. Certain words are used with people of certain age, right? Country-wise also, geographical limitations are also important, formality, right? I cannot, for example, when I'm writing an official formal mail, I cannot say, give me a tinkle when you are free. No, please let me know when you are free, or please call me when you are free, right? Now, knowing whether the word is commonly used or not, that's also very important. In fact, if you go back to, Del Hyams, one of the masterpieces on communicative competence. If any of you have, if you have not read this particular 1973 paper on communicative competence by Del Hyams, he has beautifully given four aspects, and the fourth aspect is use. So something, whether something is possible, something is feasible, something is appropriate, and something is in use. So the fourth part is use. So we want to know whether the word is commonly used or not. You, for example, for a teacher, I'm sure somebody can say, I'm a pedagogue. But when you say, I'm a pedagogue, who will understand? How many people will understand? So it is better to know the words with the idea whether that word is a commonly used word or not. If it is not commonly used, then you can avoid using that. So knowledge of that is important, and being able to use the word receptively and productively. If somebody speaks and you understand, that's okay. But are you able to use that word in your own language? That is also an important knowledge. Rahul or Atul, can you tell me how many minutes are left for me?
Yes, sir. You can finish it in 2-3 minutes time. Sir.
2-3 minutes. Okay, fine. So whatever we have discussed, these 14 types of knowledge, that Paul Nation has tried to put it in a different way also, whether the skill is related to productive skill or receptive skill. So I'm just going to run the slides because explanation will take a lot of time. But I have divided them into three categories: form, meaning, and use. A stands for receptive, and P stands for productive. So when it comes to the form of a spoken word, what does the word sound like? So when somebody speaks, are you able to understand? And how is the word pronounced if you are going to use it in spoken form? Then written form. Then word parts. What parts are recognizable in this word? In fact, that's also a very interesting area. When you read a word which you have never ever seen earlier, but if you can recognize the parts, for example, say unpardonable. And just imagine that you have never heard that word before, unpardonable. But you have read many words where able is used, and you have read many words where un is used. So now you know, you can recognize that in this particular word, there are three parts, and probably you know the meaning of pardon. On the basis of pardon, you are able to understand the meaning of pardonable, something that can be pardoned. And you know that un is a prefix generally for making a word opposite. So unpardonable is something that you cannot pardon. So this knowledge is very important. In fact, it can open many doors. And similarly, while writing, sometimes you, if you know the parts, you can create words which are acceptable. Meaning, First was form, now it is meaning. What meaning does this word, verb form, signal? Like if it is any WS at the end, then you know that this particular word can generally mean a noun, right? So verb form can signal meaning. And if it is production, then you know what word form you have to use. Like honest and honesty, as confident and competent users, you know the difference between honest and honesty, where to use what. But for learners, for elementary learners, it may be difficult. So this knowledge is important. And concept and reference, I talked about that. For example, green, if you take the word green. Now green word, can the basic meaning, the primary concept, you know, it's the name of a color. But apart from that, it can have many uses and there may be some connection with the color. For example, somebody may have green fingers, so he likes gardening. You might wait for the green signal, right? So the main concept and the other associations, right? What other words does this make us think of? And the last, use grammatical functions. In what patterns does the word occur? And collocations, as we discussed. And collocations is such an important topic, though it is not, it was not taught in an explicit way earlier, but luckily we have many good books today, many course books where collocations are taught very nicely. And it's very easy to understand. For example, if you ask any child, would you go to a fast food restaurant or a quick food restaurant? He will immediately say fast food. So fast and food, they collocate. It's very easy to understand for them. Amitabh is a high man, not possible. Amitabh is a tall man. So tall and man, they collocate. So at a primary level also, students can understand this. And what are the constraints on the use? What words are used in what particular context? So who is communicating with whom and why? All these things are important. So my last slide here, with a large vocabulary, what can you do? So ideally I should ask you, but since we don't have time, I am just telling you straight away. With a large vocabulary, you can see more, obviously, because earlier you might have seen only a cloud, but now you will see whether nimbus or cirrus or, you know, cumulus. You can hear more, obviously, read more, think more, understand more, express more, definitely. Live more, I am not sure. But live better, guaranteed. Okay, so let me end my presentation here. Yes, over to you, Rahul and Atul.
Yes, thank you so much for a very enriching session, sir.